Welcome to the Living Beyond ADHD podcast. If you're looking for a fresh perspective and actionable steps on hot topics from focus to follow through to self-management and more, you are in the right place. Welcome your host, innovative educator, coach, and psychotherapist, Dr. B. This podcast is sponsored by Pure Potential with Dr. B. You can head over to drbarbaracohen.com and find the podcast transcript, great free content, plus information on programs and services, including the groundbreaking Adventures in Achievement online coaching program and one-to-one services with Dr. B. That's drbarbaracohen.com.
Hey, D-Dears. Today I'm continuing my interview with Danny, who in the last episode described how getting diagnosed with ADHD and learning about wins from something I taught at our local meetup group pulled him out of darkness and started him on a bright new path. In part three of this interview, I discuss cognitive hyperactivity, which is barely being talked about, even though it causes huge problems for people. And then we start talking about solutions. So settle in for some great tips as we continue Danny's interview.
There are still things that, like, ADHD is such a big part of my life. Like, it's such a big part, and it's stuff that I don't think, you know, unless they find some miracle pill or they develop some laser brain surgery, like, it's something I'll probably live with till the day I die, you know?
You know what's really interesting to me, Danny, is kind of rolling back to the beginning of what you were talking about the person that assessed you, and he said that you scored high on everything except the H part, the hyperactivity. And to me, it's just an indication of the lack of education and understanding, because your hyperactivity is cognitive hyperactivity, and it's typically not what's talked about when people talk about hyperactivity. They
sure.
Think about people
yes.
that are hyper and fidgety and moving and all the physical kinds of stuff, but there are so many adults that live with cognitive hyperactivity. Like, out here in California, the 405 is a main freeway when people are allowed to travel on the freeways more
sure.
regularly. And it's like people with cognitive hyperactivity, their brains are like any major freeway in rush hour. It doesn't stop. There's like no break, no let up in terms of the time when it's a little bit slower. It's just ongoing generating thinking machine, just spitting out all different kinds of thoughts. And they're not even necessarily random, like things that you can read about cognitive hyperactivity, which isn't much. And the idea that we do this associative thinking. And so this begets this, begets this, begets this. But that isn't the kind of thinking that I'm talking about, or that you're talking about when you talk about your brain just doesn't stop. It's not quiet. It doesn't slow down. It's on and it's off. There's two speeds.
Sure.
And I think I'm really grateful that you talked about that, because it's not something that's talked about very often at all. And I think people need to understand, because if I was going to write up your diagnosis, it would absolutely be ADHD and not ADD, because I know you have a lot of the inattentiveness stuff, but the hyperactivity is cognitive hyperactivity, and it is hyperactivity, and it does you a disservice to not identify that, yes, there is hyperactivity. It's just hearing your head and your brain and your
sure.
thoughts.
Yep.
And you know, there are people that are hyperactive in their emotions, in their affect, and they're constantly sensitive and feeling into everything, and it just doesn't stop. They're just like oozing in terms of what's going on in the affect or the feeling part of their life. And these are things that just aren't talked about mainstream. It's pretty much if you're all over the place and moving every which way and jumping across roofs and things like that, like I did as a kid, there was that. But I also have cognitive hyperactivity because my brain, I've trained it so that it isn't like that constantly all day long, because it can be trained. But the reality is that's where it started. It's just nonstop generating, and I couldn't capture it because it's just so fast. I don't know if you did this. I know I used to dictate, like I could be in my car and all these thoughts are just coming. I just turn on like my phone or a digital dictating machine in the car, set it in my lap, and just have a little thing in one ear, and I just talk. I talk as fast as anything that was going on in my head in the hopes of capturing all these thoughts, all these ideas, because at that point too, and I don't know if this is with you, my working memory wasn't that strong. And so they didn't integrate. It was just one bump, two bump, three bump, four bump, five. And it's like six ideas back. That was a great idea. Where did it go? I don't know. I'm on to the 12th idea right now. And I'm never going to get back to it if I don't find a way to capture it, because I can't write fast enough. There's some disconnect. And I don't know if this happens with you, between how fast my brain would go and trying to write that fast, even if I'm typing. It was just much easier to dictate. I could kind of keep up with my brain and the stuff that it was generating. But that's definitely hyperactivity. It needs to be seen that way, because there's also the impulsivity that you're talking about, which is I want it now. It's like, I don't want to wait. It's too slow. What do I do? What do I do now? Let's get to it. What's the solution? There's an urgency. There's that inner push to get it taken care of now. What do I do? How do I do it? When do I do it? Give me the steps so that I can do it and be done.
Yeah, so there is some of that, but I do think one of the things that attracted me to those initial meetings is you made it very clear in everything that you were talking about, at least to the meetings I was at, you made it very clear that this is a process and a lifelong process. Like, so I kind of, it's one of the things I liked about you, because I know I get ahead of myself, and that like spoke to me because I know I needed to hear that. Right. And I was ready at that point to hear that, because I had been looking for solutions. Like every self-help book I read was going to be the book that fixes me, right? So like, but they never worked. So with writing for me, it's like, I'll often go on phases where I'm reading a lot of books on writing. It was like this addiction where I think, okay, this book on writing is going to cure all my writing problems, right? But to answer, to say, step back and answer your earlier question, I don't really do dictation. One of two times where my brain slows down is when I'm forced to have to speak, right? So like my verbal seems to like override my mental, right? So like, because I like to talk, I've learned that I have to slow down my thoughts if I'm going to pay attention to what I'm saying, right? But it has its own problem in that it makes me want to talk all the time, because it's like a drug that slows down my thoughts, right? That is one of the reasons why I talk a lot, right? Among others.
And if you can hold the other piece of the thought, is there are people, which this may be you, that are verbal processors. And the way we know what we're thinking is to say it and hear it. Because thoughts are inside your head and they're going and they're going, and there's all these thoughts happening. You can't see them. You can hear them internally. And it's like you said, a cacophony. It's just this big thing that's happening. Speaking, like you said, slows down your mind, slows down your brain, so that you can consider the words that you're using and actually express what you want to say. And you get to hear what you're thinking. Where if you just leave it in your head, you might hear it, but it's just a massive amount of stuff that's going on in there and maybe not well differentiated. I don't know for you, but certainly being able to talk and process what you're thinking is a very good strategy for a lot of people. I know for a fact that you think deeply about many things. And when you want to share something, it isn't superficial. It isn't just off the top of your head, typically. It's something you've put in a lot of thought about or have a lot of context for what you're saying. And you want to share it and you want to talk about it because it's deeply meaningful to you in the way that it is, unique to you.
Sure. The other place my thoughts slow down is when I'm physically taking pen to paper, that's another way for me to get my brain to sort of slow down. Like, I don't want to make it sound like the cacophony in my head is always a pain. It can be very fun when I'm just alone and it's just me and my brain. There's some times where I can sit back and sort of enjoy that ride, but it isn't though most of the time. Most of the time it's difficult. Like, it wants to run the show and I don't like that.
It doesn't feel good when your brain isn't running the show very well. In the last episode of this 4-part interview, we'll talk about the unhealthy coping mechanisms people sometimes use. And we'll present ideas for finding healthy coping strategies instead.
Thanks for your undivided attention. If you're eager to make positive changes in your life, head over to drbarbaracohen.com to see how Dr. B can help you today. Whether you love making changes with community support in a group environment or prefer one-to-one coaching or psychotherapy, you'll find all the information you need to get started at drbarbaracohen.com.